Hey, good morning, Champions family. I am so excited to get to be with you again. We have such amazing things, and I know sometimes I use that too frequently, but I'm telling you, they are amazing things that are happening. Through our series on loving your neighbor and learning how to be servant evangelists into our world and serve one another, God has really opened doors for us to do that. I've just had so many great testimonies coming through our missional communities on how people are finding small ways to make big impacts into people's lives. One of our ladies, Sharon, in our missional community was sharing how it, just as she's been going through the drive-thru in restaurants, she's been having this stirring to pay for the people behind her. And there's one restaurant that she frequents, and she's been paying for the people behind her. Well, now she said the young man at the register has gotten in on it. So he gets excited, she says, when he pulls up to his window because he knows the good news he's about to tell to somebody else. And I said, Sharon, what an amazing thing that's going on, not just for you and not just the people behind you, but now this young man working in the restaurant, you've brought him in on the mission, that he's now a part of giving good news, sharing the love of Jesus, and he doesn't even realize it. But he gets excited because of what's happening. What is that? That's the love of God. That's the power of the Spirit of the living God working to make an impact, not just in someone that's in a car behind her, but God's doing something in that young man's life. And we're having testimonies like that. Our MC is, one of our groups is beginning to take care of a, really adopted this ministry organization that helps women who are going through abusive and traumatic situations. And they're coming out of that. And this organization works to kind of help them get up on their feet and help them find places to live and employment and supplies and resources. And so that missional community group has taken them on to provide hygiene products and materials for those ladies, and they were trying to get together and figure out what they need. And in the meantime, one of the couples from that group had to go and pick up food supplies that we use for our lunch program. And when they got to the building to pick up the food, when they got there, the volunteers were there at the building said, we've suddenly got all this health and hygiene products for women, and we don't even know what to do with them. And our folks' eyes lit up going, we know exactly what that's for, because we're helping these ladies that are coming out of abusive and traumatic situations, and we're just now needing supplies to help them. And it was God who set this whole thing up. So now they filled up their van with all of these hygiene products that one group didn't know why, but the other group said, we know exactly why. God has supplied what's needed so we can show these women that they value and they matter to God. And we're just seeing some crazy God things line up as we're getting the heart of God and understanding what it is to reach out to our world with love and compassion. One of the things I want to share with you before we get into today's message is our Twigs summer program is about to come to an end. And we've really been praying, God, we don't want to end the connection we're building with the families that are coming through and receiving lunches. So many are having conversations, and some are asking for help and prayer and counsel. And it's been just an awesome thing to watch the connection that's happening. And we said, Lord, we don't want that to end. And so we said, God, give us an opportunity, some way, even though our summer program's ending and school is beginning, what can we do? And this happened just the other day, that one of the administrators from the school district came to our volunteers and he said, what if you could continue feeding at least once a week? Would that even be possible? And our volunteers just almost flew because they got so excited. This was an answer to prayer. To think that we can now continue encountering people and sharing with people and getting involved in their lives and being asked by the school district to do so through acts of service, acts of love, reaching out. And so I say that to also say, I need your help. We need your help financially to continue to provide meals and the resources we do to provide milk products and other family needs as we continue helping during this crazy, chaotic time that we're in. And so your financial giving ensures that that happens, because the lunches we provide, the backpacks we provide, the other resources and materials we provide, they all cost us. None of that is free. And so it's your giving that can helps us continue to do the ministry that we're doing there in Valley Park. And so I'm asking you to pray about continuing to give to help feed our families and to reach out in Valley Park as God is opening that door. And I believe that He is. I believe that He's blessing us so that we can bless others and see their lives begin to change as His loving kindness shows upon them. Hey, I love you so much. And as we get into today's message, just remember this. God does love you. And because of the love He has shown to you, let's allow that love to flow through us. In the film Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, at the very end of the movie, you see Willy Wonka has given to all of the kids who are going through the tour an everlasting gobstopper. And unfortunately, through the tour, four of the five kids get in quite a bit of predicament and trouble, and they're taken from the tour. And all that's left is little Charlie and his Uncle Joe. And when they get to the very end, Mr. Wonka says goodbye and he's walking away. And Uncle Joe says, "Hey, wait a second. What about the big prize, the lifetime supply of chocolate that Charlie was supposed to get?" And all of a sudden, Willy Wonka just goes berserk and he is yelling at Charlie and Uncle Joe about how they had disobeyed the rules because they had taken fizzy lifting drinks. And so that makes the contract null and void. There's no chocolate. There's no nothing. Just leave. And as Uncle Joe is ready to leave, he turns to Charlie and he says, "We'll get our revenge. We'll get back at him. We're going to sell that everlasting gobstopper candy to Wonka's competitor, Slugworth." And so they're getting ready to leave, and Charlie stops and he turns around and he walks over to where Mr. Wonka is sitting, and he puts that gobstopper on his desk and he turns and walks away. And you slowly see Willy Wonka's hand reach over and touch that everlasting gobstopper. And he quotes a line from Shakespeare. And he says, "So shines a good deed in a weary world." And he turns around and he tells Charlie and Uncle Joe, "You've won. You've won not only the lifetime supply of chocolate, but you've won the entire chocolate factory. I want you to move in here. Your family move in here. I'm going to train you, teach you all the secrets to how to develop chocolate. And you're going to be the head of Willy Wonka Candy Factory." And so that's the end of the movie. Big hurrah, big hooray. But that quote really stuck with me. "So shines a good deed in a weary world." As our series on Love Your Neighbor has been taking place over the last several weeks, we've really been looking at how are we to serve our world. As we're in a very crazy and chaotic time, the church is being called to action, to stand up and to serve our world, which is hurting and broken and angry and hopeless. And we are to display the light of God through good deeds in a weary world. Unfortunately, a lot of times these acts of kindness, we kind of lump them in as just acts of charity or acts of pity or just being nice. Whenever you use the word kindness, unfortunately in our American language, we put it as being nice. We define it as just being nice to someone, as to show charity. If we did something good for somebody else, we helped someone who was homeless or someone on the side of the road, we put that in as being nice because we saw them and we felt bad. And then when we look at scripturally, we think kind of the same thing, that God is just calling us to do good deeds. He's just calling us to feel sorry for people and to be nice to them and try to help them out. Well, unfortunately, that's not the case. Being nice and scriptural kindness are not the same thing. Scriptural kindness, really and truthfully, is an action and an attitude of God the Father to us and through us. It's not just being nice to someone. When we are kind, we are displaying the heart of God to the people around us. I want you to go to Romans chapter 2, verse 4, because this verse kind of gives us a definition of what it means to be kind and display the kindness of God. Romans chapter 2, verse 4, in the New King James Version says this: "Or do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God," pay attention to this last segment, "that the goodness of God leads you to repentance." Now look at the New Living Translation of the same verse. "Can't you see that his kindness is intended to turn you from your sin?" And then the NIV, New International Version, says, "not realizing that God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance." And then the Message, and I love how that says this, "that the kindness of God leads you to a radical life change." Well, that can't just mean pity. The kindness of God is making a radical shift, a change in your life. Not just somebody handed you a couple bucks because they felt sorry for you. Spiritual kindness is not the same as being nice to someone. Spiritual kindness, as we see according to Scripture, is God's heart to us. It's his display to us. It's his love in action to you and I. And when we encounter it, it causes a mind change, a heart change, and a life change. Now, that may happen quickly or it may happen over time, but that's what his kindness, his goodness does to us. Well, that's more than just giving someone a dollar or two because they needed some gas money. The kindness of God does something far deeper than that. And to understand it, let's look at the Greek word there for kindness or goodness. The Greek word there is krustos, and it means to fit or to fit for use or to be useful. That's what that word kindness and goodness means. It means you're actually being fit because there is use for you. And so the image you and I need to see is that God, in his acts of goodness, in his acts of kindness, in his display of love to you and I, what he's saying is you matter. You fit. There is a use for you. You have value. You have worth. When we're just nice to somebody and throwing them a couple bucks to get a hamburger or to get some gas, we're not necessarily saying you have worth. We're just saying I feel bad for you. But the actions of God that he's wanting to display through us to serve one another says you matter to the kingdom of God. You have worth to the kingdom of God. You fit. You have a place to fit in God's kingdom. And his goodness towards you shows you that. The greatest display of that is John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he did" what? "He gave his only begotten son." He saw that you and I have value. We have worth. We fit somewhere. We matter. And so he said, "I'll show you that you matter by sending my son to be the savior of the world, to be the Lord of your life." And we often don't grasp that concept. And because of it and our sin and our selfishness, we're actually rebelling against God's goodness. We're fighting against the one who really and truly cares for us and sees the value in each one of us. And so we fight against him. The Bible says we're rebelling against him. And a great example of this is from the show Hoarders. And if you know me real well, you know I really enjoy that show. Not because it's something I mock or make fun of, but because to me it is a living example of what is really happening in the lives of everyday people. If you've never seen the show before, what they do is they go to a person's home who has been a collector, a hoarder, if you will, and they've collected garbage or trash, or maybe they have collected antiques or things they found on the side of the road, and they've shopaholics, and they've just filled their homes and filled their property to the point where they aren't even hardly able to live a normal existence in that house. And they've hoarded, they've brought all of this stuff in. And usually in the course of the show, they'll find out that at some point those individuals had some kind of pain or traumatic moment that really shifted their mindset, and they began to isolate and insulate themselves from the world and try to control their lives by controlling stuff. And so then you see a friend or a family member or someone in the neighborhood who cared enough to say, we need to get you some help. And so they bring in a therapist or a psychologist or an organizer, professional organizer, or professional cleaning teams to come and help this person see the way you're living is not healthy. It's not healthy for you physically, mentally, emotionally. Let us help you because you matter. You have a place. And too often those individuals feel like their lives don't matter. And so they live among the garbage because they feel like they are garbage. And as the people begin to work with them, suddenly they find themselves being fought against. That individual rebels against the help because you're trying to take what's mine or I can't control this anymore. And it's a living example of what you and I have done to Father God. He's extended his love to us. While we were still sinners, the Bible says, Christ died for us. While we were in our mess and our garbage, God extended love to us. And he says, you matter. Don't live among the garbage anymore. Clear out the garbage from your heart and your mind and your life. You matter to the kingdom. You matter to Father God. You matter to the family of God. So let's pull you out of there. I don't call you garbage. I don't call you worthless. I don't call you a mistake. I don't call you a loser. I call you my child because I love you. And here's what he really says over us in Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3. He says, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and I have drawn you with my, look at what it says, loving kindness. That word drawn means to lift you out with my loving kindness. It's not pity. It's not because I felt sorry for you. I extended my loving kindness towards you. And I am lifting you out of the garbage. I'm lifting you out of the mess. I'm lifting you out of your sin and your selfishness. And I'm drawing you to me. You're no longer an orphan or a stranger. You're no longer pushed into the margin. But I've drawn you to myself with my loving kindness. He displayed that love to us. While we were still in our mess and our sin, God loved this world and he gave his only begotten son. And he's now, you that have come into the family of God, he's saying, because of what you have received, that loving kindness has come to you. Now let's extend that loving kindness to the world in small ways, in big ways, in acts of kindness. Demonstrate that people have value and they have worth. They matter to God and they fit. They have purpose in the grand scheme of eternity. A great example of this happened this week. I was taking my son to physical therapy, and while we're sitting there in the waiting room, I was scrolling through my contacts list on my phone, and a name popped out that I haven't talked to in quite a while. And I just sent a simple text to this person. I said, hey, I saw your name, praying for you today. Don't know if there's anything specific I can pray with you about. You're just on my mind. Not too long after, I received a text back, said, yeah, there are some things, and listed several things to pray. And in that text, they said, I know this was from God. This text reminded me that I matter to God and I am on His mind, and it's made an impact today. I matter to God. And I thought, wow, such a small thing, just a few minutes of time to say a prayer and send a text. But those acts of kindness changed someone's day. Why? Because they realized I matter to God. I fit in the family. I fit in the work for the kingdom. Little things done, but they matter so much. And Jesus gives a great example of this in the parable he tells in Matthew 25. He says the king is standing there and he speaks to those on his right hand. And he says to them in Matthew 25, when I was thirsty and when I was hungry and when I was naked, you fed me and you gave me water and you clothed me. And those that were standing there said, when did we do this, God? In Matthew 25, verse 40 says, the king will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Jesus is saying, every act of kindness you did, when you handed a meal to somebody, when you gave them a drink, when you clothed them, when you visited them in prison, when you went to them when they were sick, all these little things you did, but they were acts of kindness. They were displaying the love of the Father through your life to that person. They mattered and it made a difference. You honored them. And because you honored them, you honored me. It wasn't an act of pity. It wasn't because you felt sorry for them. You truly cared. You saw the value. You saw where they fit. And you said, you need food because you need your strength to do what God's called you to do. You need this drink to nourish you. You need clothing. You need strength when you were sick and when you were in prison. You needed a friend. Why? Because you matter and you fit in the kingdom of God. And there are so many people who don't know that they matter to God. They do not understand. And you and I have the privilege, because we have received that love, that we can demonstrate that love and see change take place in their lives. Goodness of God brings people to repentance. It's not pity. It's not charity. It's the compassion of God flowing through your life to say, you matter to the Father and you fit in His kingdom and in this family. In the video, you're about to see testimony from a young woman named Chloe, who's working as a captain of a boat on the Chicago River. And it's a male-dominated career, but she's been working to build her prestige and move up the ladder and make herself known. And in her striving to find an identity as a boat captain, she's lost her identity in Christ, lost her purpose in the kingdom. And when God reawakens her to that fact, she begins to turn around to the people around her and saying, I've realized the value I have, and now I need to share that value with you. Watch what happens.
I've worked on the Chicago River for about 6 years, and I've been a captain for 4. A lot of older generations will look at me and say, oh, we have a lady captain, or ooh, there's a girl driving. I am a pretty significant minority in my career field, and it just means that I have to work extra hard. The first 2 years that I was a captain, I had to spend a lot of time proving that I was valuable. I had just started my second year as being a captain, and I was on a significantly larger boat, and the expectation for me to perform at the same level as my peers was overwhelming to me. Being surrounded by a very machismo culture of, you know, pilots that are extremely good at what they do was very discouraging for me. And there were many points that summer where I wanted to quit, I wanted to give up, I didn't think I was valuable. I had a bit of a meltdown at work. Ended up just completely and sobbing at the end of the day and feeling pretty useless and pretty vulnerable. I was trying to prove myself so much. I was trying to, you know, garner my value from being a boat handler, that I lost touch of where my identity truly lies. Instead of, you know, being the best captain on the Chicago River and making that full for my heart, I finally sat down and really heard God speaking to me about my identity, and that when God sees me, he only sees his son. He doesn't see the flaw-filled Chloe that drives the water taxi. I am full from that. I am able to share my hope with others. I work with a lot of men who claim to be atheists. There have been times of difficulty in each of their lives over the last 6 years that I've known a few of these men, and I've told them that God loves them and that they have a place in eternity if they so choose. And I think that's been huge. It may not change their mind overnight, but slowly chipping away at what they know to be true. If I'm willing to come to the conversation with an open heart and an open mind, and they have hard questions they want to ask me that I'm more than willing to answer, it really opens up a lot of their insecurity and their anxiety in a way that we can just have an open dialogue. I'd say that's one of my favorite parts of my job, is just being available for people. One of my coworkers, she found out this summer that she has cancer in her lymph nodes. And I was actually working with her the day that she found out her test results. And through that whole experience, though it's been dark and often painful for her to have to kind of reach into the hard places in her heart, I've been really able to show her the love of God, and specifically my hope in Christ, and that she does have a purpose, that she does have the opportunity for an afterlife, and to serve something greater than herself. The fact that I'm the only Christian that I work with is a huge asset for God's work on the Chicago River. Because if I hadn't been there that day, she might not have heard any hope. She might not have had any sort of good thing to hang on to other than her own, you know, friends and family. So I think it's invaluable. It certainly hasn't been easy for me, but my heart is full, and I am able to share hope with people that have no hope because of Christ and because of what I've gone through in my own life.
You just saw where Chloe, in very small ways, but expressing God's love to people, began to have a chance to speak and pray and encourage. What is she doing? She's showing you have value. In just those simple words to someone, she's revealing Father's heart, that you matter, you have purpose. Stop fighting against the one who really loves you. Stop pushing against the one who cares so much for you. Just like the hoarders, sometimes they can't see the mess they're in. It takes someone else from a different perspective to see there's a better way. You're dying in your filth and your selfishness and your choices. And look what it's done. It's buried you alive. And I hear the Father's heart saying to you and I, look around you. And you're buried by your choices. You've buried yourself alive with your own thoughts and foolishness and selfishness and sin. And he extends his love, his goodness and kindness to us, and says, I'll draw you out. I'll lift you up. And now you and I get the privilege of sharing that same message to the world that's around us. Look around, so many hurting people, so many hopeless people, and those small acts of kindness, small actions of love, penetrating to the very heart, and saying it doesn't have to be this way. You fit. You matter in the kingdom. What did our scripture say from the message? The kindness of God leads to a radical life change. And sometimes a change happens when we're ministering and helping and serving people. Their lives are being affected, but also my life is being affected. My life is being changed. Those kind words, kind actions reveal the value in those people and reveals the power and the wondrous love of God that he has shown to us. reminding me once again how great and gracious and good and glorious my God truly is. I'm challenging us through this series, stop looking inwardly and begin to look outwardly. As God's kindness comes to us, it has to go through us. Here's a quote from Mother Teresa. She said, "Kind words can be short and easy to speak, but their echoes can truly be endless." I want to pray for us today that the words, the actions, as we see the value in other people, that they echo in their life. Those small actions are that seed planted that begins to grow and blossom into something beautiful. That the loving kindness of God truly does bring a change in thought and heart and life. And they allow His love to draw them out of the mess, the garbage, the hoard, and come into the beautiful, wondrous life that God has for them. Let's pray today. Father God, I pray for us first, that we would understand the power of Your kindness that has come to us. As Your word says, it's Your goodness, Your kindness that leads us to repentance, causes a radical change. And Father, unfortunately, we have kind of watered that down, but it is such a powerful fact. Our lives are radically changed when we understand the goodness and kindness that You have shown to us, that You display the fact that we matter in the kingdom, we fit and have purpose and we have value. And I pray that God, as we're understanding that, just like Chloe had that understanding, let it then be flow out of us, that we want to share that through acts of kindness and words of love and deeds of goodness to other people, that it shines in the weary world that we live in. And that goodness, that loving kindness is what draws people back to You. Out of darkness into the light, out of the garbage heap and into the family of God. They need it today. They need it. God, don't let us keep sitting around and making excuses, but let us put action to our beliefs today. Let us reach out through the compassion of Jesus Christ, not out of pity, not of just doing something nice, but because the love of God compels us to say, You have worth. You matter. You matter. And I pray for opportunities. Let us notice people and reach out in those small ways and see amazing results for the kingdom of God. We love You. Holy Spirit, You are moving through us, and we give You praise for all that You're doing, because it is You who are doing the work through us. And we love You today. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, before you go, let me just challenge you. Don't just sit there today, wherever you're at watching this video. Don't just sit and go, nice words, good words. I dare you to put action. Do something today, whether it's a simple text, whether it's buying someone's meal, whether it's just writing an email to somebody. I don't care what you do. But ask God, God, put somebody on my heart today. Put somebody in my path today that I can show the loving kindness of God, where they realize they matter. They matter to the kingdom. And it begins the starting place for a radical change in their life. Hey, I love you so much. And God loves you too. Remember this, you are a champion.